are about to take part in a time-traveling road trip through pop culture. A road trip with a clear destination and many stops along the way. This is but one act of one chapter of the serialized journey.
So if any of you feel that you do not care to subject your nerves to such a strain, now is your chance to, we've warned you.
I'm Cherokee Jack.
When we last left off, we continued our long odyssey into MST3K's sixth season by playing a round of the most dangerous game, attempted to take a flight out of San Francisco International, braved the homophobic racism of the Iger sanction, and tried to make the correlation between robotic ennui and having seen Cliffhanger. This week is all about Hollywood's forgotten nihilist, Full Metal Curly himself, Coleman Francis. We'll take the second off-ramp to the danger zone, enter a zone of a different kind in quote-unquote Cuba, and seriously wonder, flag on the moon, how did it get there? As always, I am Ryan Rodriguez, and you were stuck with the Coolness Chronicles Season 1, The History and Legacy of Mystery Science Theater 3000. Chapter 9, Top of the Basic Cable Mountain, Act 4, The Cinematic Poet of Parking. If I may be so bold, I'd like to open this hour of the podcast with the words of His Holiness, Kevin Murphy. Coleman Francis uses edits like blunt instruments. He uses blunt instruments like blunt instruments. His major themes are death, hatefulness, death, pain, and death. He looks like Curly Howard, possessed by the demons from hell. He tried to pass off Lake Mead for the Caribbean Sea. His films have the moral compass of David Berkowitz. He hurt us, and I want him to know it, except if he's still alive, because there's a chance that he's still strong enough to crush my windpipe with his bare hands. For a slightly saltier take, the Honorable Frank Conniff. Personally, I've never blown a guy in a dark alley as a way to obtain an 8-ball, but I'm guessing that it's similar to the feeling one gets when watching Coleman Francis films, although at least in the former instance there's a fun-sized portion of freebase at the end of the rainbow, whereas with the latter, you get a migraine and damaged eyes that weep blood. Well said, sirs. When the name Coleman Francis is bandied about, and that's rarely considering that most people outside of Misty's and other bad movie cineasts are unaware of his existence, the response is usually, "Who?" Hell, the Turner Classic Movies database has his limited filmography coupled with the biography of Anne Francis, the lovely star of Honey West and Forbidden Planet. Born in 1919, he was an outsider that lived on the fringes of obscurity, armed with a nebulous vision, the bare amount of skill required to assemble a film, and crippling alcoholism. He had curious fetishes, like scenes that revolve around, but never actually get to, the drinking of coffee, and denouements that always feature vigilante gunmen in light aircraft assassinating a central character. He was forgotten by the film industry long before his death in 1973, which was attributed to arteriosclerosis, but was, according to his producer Anthony Cardoza, likely suicide. But between August 1994 and January 1995, MST3K's sixth season featured all three of the films he directed and co-produced in his lifetime. 1961's The Beast of Yucca Flats, 1963's The Skydivers, and 1966 Night Train to Mundo Fine, renamed Red Zone Cuba, albeit out of order, reintroducing his work to a new audience, or rather the first real audience. Since then, he has been reappraised as possibly the worst filmmaker of all time, with his work usually mentioned in the same breath as Edward D. Wood, Jr., which is usually not the greatest creative legacy to live. But I will say, to his credit, I believe that without his nihilistic trilogy of incompetence, MST3K might be worse off. I know that everyone involved with the show wishes that they never cross paths with Coleman, but I personally believe that it is when the writers and performers are challenged by a vision as bleak or boring as his that it results in some great transgressive art. So let's go back to the middle and get this retrospective going with Experiment 609.
Well, Mike, I got a good one for you today. It's a little thing called Skydiver. It's kind of like Manos without the lucid plot.
Skydivers, they fall free from 20,000 feet above the earth and experience the epitome of freedom and movement that only eagles have known before.
Hey, Bob, you're going to ride piggyback, aren't you?
We're going to try it.
They're thrill-jumping guys who attract thrill-seeking gals, like Susie, a more-more gal, never satisfied with one man.
The Skydivers is about... I'm sorry, that's a funny word to use in this situation. Okay, let's start over again. In grayed-out, sun-bleached, scenic New Mexico, an unhappily married husband and wife, Harry and Beth, own and operate a skydiving facility on a tiny airstrip.
Filmed in despair vision.
Beth, who in every scene looks like someone with alopecia wearing a helmet made out of hair, suspects that Harry, played by producer Anthony Cardoza, Tony to his friends, and whoever assembled the credits, is having an affair. Sidebar. Cardoza, in addition to producing all of Coleman Francis's illustrious efforts, is also responsible for Experiment 209, The Hellcats, best remembered as that biker movie with all the swastikas that is, and I'm hazy on this, likely not the same movie as Sidehackers. Don't quote me on that. End sidebar. We learn that Beth's suspicions of Harry's philandering are correct when he's seen taking a philandering dip in Lake Mead with a shifty floozy named Susie.
Beth, you're pretty in your picture.
Joe Moss, how are you? Oh, it seems like I've known you all my life. I've heard so much about you. How was your trip?
Great.
Good.
Great.
How about some coffee?
Coffee?
What is this coffee?
I like coffee.
Good.
And thus we peer into the complex inner workings of this character. So, how long have you liked coffee?
Where is it, your coffee?
So she's hooking up with Donald O'Connor now, huh?
Mm-hmm. So, coffee or...
Shut up! Shut up!
I like this place.
We like it. I'd like it better if it were paid for, though.
Well?
I know.
What?
I'm pretty.
Where's the general?
The general? Oh! He had to go into the village and check the troops.
Weren't you saying something about some coffee?
No, I think you're right.
The coffee underachievers.
Coffee's a major plot point.
Mm-hmm. Ooh, I wonder who this is going to be. Let's see. Oh, good. Now the scene's going to pick up.
There we go.
Susie the Floozy is also screwing Frankie, who was fired from Harry and Beth's quote-unquote facility for drinking on the job. They'll come back later. With a vacancy on the payroll, Harry reaches out to his friend named Joe, another Coleman Francis fetish, and as it turns out, Joe and Beth have an instant rapport, which leads to the second Francis fetish.
Enjoy this tribute to white, white bodies.
We're so pink and really white. Thank you for bringing me to the Eel Pout Festival.
In bafflingly edited sequence after bafflingly edited sequence, people enter frame and speak to someone clearly not in the same location, only for a jump cut to reveal the person being spoken to, then a jump cut back. These scenes are usually juxtaposed with B-roll of people driving cars from one part of the facility to another, lingering on their parking jobs.
Seems like they forgot to have things happen in this movie.
Yes.
Yeah, that's it.
Bob, you ready?
Wait, he was there, and now the plane was...
Someone with attention deficit disorder edited this film.
While Francis, the director, is on autopilot, if in the cockpit at all, Francis, the writer, is grasping for profundity, having the actors frequently ask each other why they do what they do, possibly because Francis doesn't have an answer to the question himself and is hoping for some kind of catharsis through character.
Is it burning?
Yeah, I think so. Feels good making like a bird. Floating around up there.
Pooping on people.
You know, Beth.
I'm Rita Moreno.
If I couldn't jump once in a while.
What'd you ask me?
I think I'd crack up. I don't know. Seems like I get rid of all my worries every time I jump.
I guess that's why most of us jump.
Me? I want to be a dandelion.
Or maybe we're scared.
Maybe we're dumb.
Maybe we...
La 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 la. I'm not
jump
listening.
We prove that we're not scared.
Anytime you're ready.
Ah. Oh, 5 minutes, Terry.
And just when you're sure that nothing of import is going to happen, a hotshot skydiver, played by Coleman's brother Pete, wants to jump at a federally unacceptable height, which Harry reluctantly helps him do in the first scene to actually attempt tension.
Wonder how high they're going to jump. I don't know.
Well, they really captured that kind of situation, didn't they?
As extras from Eraserhead look on, Kid Brother Skydiver fails to open his chute and plummets to his death, a tragedy that prompts the FAA to close the facility for about 20 minutes. While temporarily jobless and noticing that his wife and Joe are clearly having coffee together, Harry takes to the local tavern where he rebuffs the advances of Susie. Incensed, Susie frolics with Frankie, told you he'd be back, at Lake Mead, presumably because the location didn't require a permit, in a purely musical sequence.
Sure. Why are they cranking the Rimsky-Korsakov?
Hey, hey! Hey! Hey, hey!
You know, this lake has artificial bass environment written all over it.
Now it's a scow! The boat is a shapeshifter!
Hold it, I sliced my foot on a beer can. Hold it.
Frolicking has never been so depressing.
After the throes of passion, Susie instructs Frankie to put acid in Harry's parachute, even though his facility is closed down and he consequently won't be jumping anytime soon. But wait! The facility is allowed to reopen. Harry and Beth have since reconciled and pushed Joe to the curb, which he seems to be totally cool with, and there's a big party to celebrate.
Thank you. That's good. That's enough. Thank you.
I assume Ike didn't know this was going on.
Susie and Frankie obtain the acid and put it in Harry's chute, and he goes up to jump with a few fellow divers who land without incident.
Huh? Now come on, I thought someone was gonna die.
Yeah, make with the death.
Yeah.
Then Harry jumps. His acid-laced chute fails, and he is crushed into the earth. Susie and Frankie were spotted before the plummet, so Coleman Francis, in an uncredited cameo, shoots them both dead from a plane. Fetish alert! In an attempt to provide some levity to this riveting drama, Mike and the bots notice that the propeller planes resemble a smiling cartoon face, and a new character is born.
Hi, kids, it's me, Petey Plane.
Oh, I've got a cold, but it's okay. Do you know the Petey Plane song?
It's Petey Plane. It's Petey Plane.
Shut up and taxi, Petey Plane.
But the kids.
Shut up.
Send your postcards to me, Petey Plane, care of this station.
Petey saved us again, Joe.
Come on, boys. Petey's waiting for us back at the hangar.
Good, Harry. They look like big seagulls.
Yeah, seagulls.
You know, without Petey, the whole town could have been flooded.
Hi, I'm Petey's dad. Is Petey off on another adventure? I'll keep my eye out for communism.
Beth, now a widow, shuts down the facility and walks into the gray desert, defeated by the pointlessness of life, and Francis chooses to end with a Mercury Theater-like curtain call set to deafening silence.
Now I can do what I really want to, which is... I'm not sure. What color is my parachute?
Yeah, this was really a chick film.
Kevin Casey died in a mysterious parachute accident. Eric Tomlin died in a mysterious parachute accident.
Oh, God, remember this scene? This was great.
Silently, dismally, the credits roll on.
Well, to be honest, the test audiences weren't thrilled with this guy.
An actor called Bob?
As the cut face creature.
But it's not an entirely depressing experience. It's a step up from other films in the aerial action genre.
I don't know, I still like this movie better than Top Gun.
Oh, yes.
A lot better.
Let's jet back, see what I did there, to the year of my birth, 1986, and discuss the sweaty, flesh-filled blockbuster... Top Gun. Top Gun is essentially an extended recruitment advertisement for the Navy of the 80s, filtered through the all-style, no-substance MTV aesthetic that was standard for the box office juggernaut producing duo of Jerry Bruckheimer and Don Simpson, building on the formula that they established in Flashdance, which will lead us on another detour a long time from now. It grossed the astronomical adjusted for inflation equivalent of $800 million more than 30 years ago, a sizable percentage of which was likely spent on Hollywood prostitutes or went directly into Don Simpson's nasal cavity. It starred young, up-and-coming, unknown talent Thomas Cruise as a fighter pilot codenamed Maverick, which must have really pissed off James Garner. Maverick's goal in the film was to graduate an elite flight school, bro around with his best bro Goose, namesake of the space kitty from Captain Marvel, match wits with Iceman, played by Val Kilmer, sadly not founding X-Man Bobby Drake, and eventually nail Kelly McGillis from Witness. Along the way, Kenny Loggins is allowed to prove that he can do more than make the Caddyshack go for dance, the evil principal from Back to the Future sweats and glowers a lot, and somehow the band Berlin won an Academy Award for Best Original Song. To be fair, it's a visually pleasing experience if you can look past the endless smug grins on display, which is entirely attributable to Ridley Scott's late kid brother Tony, otherwise known for that David Bowie lesbian vampire movie and the genuinely wonderful True Romance. Tony, being a Scott, loved his smoke machines and close-ups of perspiration in action, and was apparently keenly aware of the homoeroticism that lay beneath the movie's surface of hyper-masculinity and almost sexual fetishizing of sleek machines that go boom. This is never more clear than an extended shirtless volleyball match set to a song called Playin' with the Boys.
It actually got voted the favorite scene in any movie for 3 years in a row by Suck Magazine. And because all those guys had their gear off. And I didn't quite know what to do with the scene. I knew why the scene was in the movie. It was there to show off all the guys. But I didn't have a point of view behind the scene. So I shot the shit out of it and got the guys to take all the gear off of them, their pants, and sprayed them in baby oil and sweat. And I didn't have a vision about what I was doing other than just doing soft porn.
It's astounding to see something that is, on its face, a conservative wet dream where war is sexy, be transgressive in a way that the target audience was oblivious to. Of course, it would be nice to instead have an actual progressive phenomenon, but this was the 80s, where every step forward was seemingly accidental. This movie was one of the original Riff Tracks titles, and was the second to feature Bill Corbett as Michael J. Nelson's wingman. Some of it is great, but there's also a large chunk devoted to gay jokes that are increasingly uncomfortable, even if they are accurately reading the subtext.
Yes. Good lord.
Why don't they just strip off the jumpsuits, form a huge pile of naked men? You know that's what this is all leading to.
It's a track that I don't think would get recorded today, 13 years later, but it's still less offensive than the Ian McKellen jokes in X-Men The Last Stand, which made me yell, "Grow up!" at my television, but I digress. There is one good thing I can say about Top Gun that I utter with no trace of irony. Without it, we wouldn't have Hot Shots. But that's a topic for another season. Literally. The second Coleman Francis opus featured on this show was his final directorial effort, if not his worst. It certainly tied for that dishonor. It's Experiment 619, Red Zone Cuba. I've got to confess something. I've seen this experiment somewhere in the range of 16 to 18 times, and in my last viewing, which was less than a month before writing this, I fully realize that I have never had a fucking clue about what transpires during this movie. I only grasp that it's about neck waddles, miserable men, cigarettes, and the lighting and smoking of said cigarettes. But I'll try my best to explain this impenetrable narrative through online synopses. I would apologize for the inconsistencies, but that's Coleman's job. We open in the present day, 1965, when a reporter approaches train engineer John Carradine, who was entering his third phase of decomposition at the time of filming. A reporter asks him about three desperados, Cook, Griffin, and Landis, that apparently hopped one of his trains at some point. You could ask, why does this reporter care? How is he aware of these convicts? But such inquisition is futile. Coleman didn't care, and soon, neither will you. Carradine says that he barely noticed them, but that Griffin ran all the way to hell. Then we jump back in time to 1961, presumably working up to that fateful train jumping, which I have some thoughts on later. Through the opening credits, we're introduced to the aforementioned Griffin, an escaped convict running across hillsides and crawling under randomly installed barbed wire. Griffin is played by Coleman himself, strongly resembling a legendary stooge.
Coleman Francis is Curly Howard in The Fugitive.
Fun fact sidebar. Coleman's other acting credits include bit parts on lots of middling 50s and 60s TV series, playing the likes of henchmen, bailiffs, and moving men. He also had uncredited roles in Film Crew and later Riff Trax's classic Killers from Space, Next Chapter's This Island Earth, and a Commando Cody series based on the shorts featured in Season 1, playing Guy in Power Plant, Answering Phone, Express Delivery Man, and Security Guard, respectively. End sidebar. As the credits continue, Carradine serenades us with his dulcet tones over stock shots of the rest of the cast and more of Coleman running.
Night train to Mundo Fina. Night train to the end. Running hard and running fast to meet my future and away from my past. Taking the gamble that cannot last. Night train to the end. Hell's ride to Mundo Fina.
Griffin, evading the police, comes across the other two men the reporter asked about, Cook and Landis, played by producer Tony Cardoza and Harold Saunders. Don't ask me who plays who. I have no clue. Griffin intends to hold up the two men at gunpoint and steal their car, but is instead invited to smoke and have coffee, fetish alert, and beans with them. They reveal that they too are ex-cons, although they serve their time. Together, the three men discuss joining the military as part of the Bay of Pigs invasion, with the possibility of $1,000 for enlisting and $1,000 once the job is done, all in cash. They need someone to fly them to a training facility. I'm not sure how that's how enlisting ever worked, but whatever. And that man is the shifty Cherokee Jack.
Cherokee Jack?
Yeah, I'm Cherokee Jack.
Cherokee Jack, whose airstrip looks suspiciously like the skydiving company from Skydivers, because it is, flies the men to the facility. Because people unofficially affiliated with the army can just fly onto government property. During the Cold War. The three stooges meet their enlistment officer, who asks for their names and such for their checks. Their confidence betrayed, the stooges try to escape the facility, but are captured and put in a relatively nice bungalow, where they prepare for their upcoming training, and Griffin stews in his own hate juice.
Must be a railroad highway somewhere around here. I'd do 5 years to get that Cherokee's throat in my hands. Nothing I hate more than a liar.
Don't worry, we'll get out of here.
Well, I feel better just talking about it. Thanks, guys.
Our auteur, ladies and gentlemen.
Thus begins the riveting and somewhat endless training sequence, which consists of shots of schlubs climbing ropes on inclines, jumping off small cliffs, shooting craps, and a circa 1961 PowerPoint presentation. Weapons training? Apparently unimportant for invading enemy countries armed to the teeth.
This film dares you to watch it.
Then, a small boat drops the troops off at a beach in Cuba. Yeah, Cuba.
I think the location scout was a spaz.
They climb the infamous Cuban cliffs, which serendipitously already have ropes dangling from them for easy access. Within minutes, they're captured by Cuban forces and are sentenced to sit in a shack to smoke more cigarettes and await execution. It's then that Griffin gets somber and philosophical.
For this next shot, let's focus on me with my legs splayed and my enormous package spread out.
Oh, their lives haven't changed at all.
Bay of Pigs.
That's what they say when I go swimming.
I just can't get worked up for this war.
I mean, you couldn't lose money on a Bay of Pigs film at this time. The country was Bay of Pigs crazy.
I'm with you, brother. Bay of Pigs. Right on.
As they await their deaths, Griffin comes up with a convoluted plan for escape that involves getting their wounded and presumably dying superior officer water and strangling the compliant guards. They have a lot of time to conspire because the Cuban army is taking their sweet time putting each soldier in front of the firing squad and taking long breaks in between.
So the rest of the movie is just watching them all get shot one by one?
I may enjoy it.
Their terrible plan kicks into high gear, and they get the requested water, but drink most of it before giving it to the wounded officer. While begging them to take him along on their escape, which they decidedly do not do, he tells them that back in his homeland, his family owns a tungsten mine. They subdue or kill a guard, pick one, I don't care, and escape to a Cuban airfield that looks suspiciously like Cherokee Jack's airfield, which looks suspiciously, you get the picture. They sneak aboard a plane and fly back somewhere in the U.S. that looks identical to the foreign country they just fled. They come across a cafe, drink some coffee, throw the cafe owner down a well, and in the uncut version of the movie, Griffin rapes the cafe owner's blind daughter.
Well, see, the movie has finally thrown up its hands and said, I just don't know.
I want to hurt this movie, but I can never hurt it the way it hurt me.
They steal the defiled family's car and drive the car to the New Mexico train yard mentioned in the cold open. Despite John Carradine being previously interviewed about an encounter with the Stooges, he does not appear in this scene. Or if he does, he was cut out of the MST version.
John Carradine is really good in this movie.
Here's where the movie's utter pointlessness is made glaringly clear. Coleman's original title was, just like the theme song, Night Train to Mundo Fine, translated as Night Train to the End of the World. The cold open reporter seems interested in only the train hopping part of the story, but the Stooges hop on the train and are in an Arizona junkyard in the span of 1 minute and three cuts.
Ah, my neck got broken in that jump cut.
It's the least eventful part of the journey, and not even the end of said journey. Skydivers delivers the title's promise of skydiving. The Beast of Yucca Flats is about a beast in the flats, but I digress. After stealing a car in the junkyard, they arrive at the superior officer's house and drink coffee with the man's wife, then gear up for a trip to the mine, and Griffin waxes poetic about eventually going straight, which lines up with his unrepentant murdering rapist persona. Then, there's a perky montage.
Everybody's having fun and smoking, and the dogs are eating too.
I feel good.
Robbing people, killing people, hopping trains is fun.
Bet she smells like Jack Del Rio's jockstrap.
This is the last of the cat. Enjoy.
Lovely with a four sleigh ride together with you.
The huge, huge face.
When the cops suddenly show up, Griffin shoots the wife. The superior officer also suddenly shows up, despite having been last seen dying in Cuba about to be shot by a firing squad. The cops arrest Landis and Cook and chase after Griffin.
A wild curly can hit 30 miles an hour when threatened.
Some cops get in a helicopter and track down Griffin, then pick him off in a hail of bullets, yet another Coleman Francis fetish. Coleman narrates Griffin's death in a mournful way, as if he was God's lonely wide load, and brings this celebration of misery and murder to a merciful close.
And when Curly dies in the wild, he provides food for other Curlies.
That was him, wasn't it? What the hell?
What is there to say about Red Zone Cuba that hasn't already been said? It's a despicable ode to the depths of man's depravity and the shallowness of Coleman Francis's ambition. But Mike may have found the silver lining.
You know, I still like this movie better than Havana.
Oh, yeah.
It's time to discuss our second long-winded run-in with Sidney Pollack, the 1990 romantic drama Havana.
Thank you. A country divided.
Nobody's interested in high-stakes poker right now. We got a little confusion going on down here.
You think I care about any of this stuff?
Perhaps you do believe in something, after all. Perhaps you believe in beautiful women, Mr. Wilde.
A time of change.
All you see here is a place for a card game because there's a fever to gamble now. But that's not what's going on.
These people want to bring down everything you're here for.
What is this? Tell me.
Why?
Because you don't want to.
A moment of choice.
I met this woman. I know her 72 hours.
Take the advice of an old man. You stick with her.
You want to change the world, Bobby? Change mine.
From Academy Award-winning director Sidney Pollack, Robert Redford, Lena Olin. Coming this Christmas. Havana.
Okay, take Casablanca, which we'll discuss much later. Bump up the setting from Morocco during World War II to 1958 Cuban Revolution, remove all the brilliant dialogue and palpable romance, inflate the runtime by about an hour, and add tons of flash and sex. There, you have Havana. As unoriginal and tiresome as it is, the cast is stellar. Robert Redford, Raul Julia, Alan Arkin, Lena Olin, Tony Plana, Richard Farnsworth, amazing people spouting cliched dialogue in the glamorized, half-whitewashed Hollywood version of a brutal time in history. A version of a conflict that was decidedly not American and specifically not Caucasian-centric, framed around the love story between two white people who were involved in an event that was actually about those who were cast on the periphery. You have a supporting cast of Cuban or at least Latin actors, which is a minimal dedication to accuracy. But because this is a big-budget, major studio movie meant to dazzle the domestic audience, they are merely there for quote-unquote realism and flavor. It's gross, frankly. And wasting an actor like Julia, whom we'll discuss in greater detail in Chapter 11 when we revisit Casablanca, who is so magnetic and charismatic, in a thankless supporting role when his time on this earth was so short, Let me just summarize that this is a tough 140 minutes. Frequently loathsome. You know what? I apologize for this humorless diatribe. Long story short, Havana the movie can go screw. Let's get back to the fun bad movies and the joke-em-ups and such. Now we've conquered so-called Cuba, both the one with a red zone and the one with the white romance. But there's one more part to Coleman Francis's oeuvre. His first feature is barely 55 minutes of barely a movie, a calling card that should have scared off any future co-worker. It's Experiment 621.
Kenneth Branagh's, Mary Shelley's, Bram Stoker's, Wes Craven's, Tim Burton's Beast of Yucca Flats, a Francis Ford Coppola film.
Coming to this theater soon, The Beast of Yucca Flats. Filmed on the burning hot sands by Yucca Flats. See terror, panic, murder. See the Cardoza and Francis production of The Beast of Yucca Flats. See a man turn killer. See a woman ravaged. See one of the most exciting movies ever made. See The Beast of Yucca Flats.
Now, as we discussed in Act 1 of Chapter 8, when Servo and Crow are putting Mike through the riffing gauntlet in his first episode as host, they mentioned this movie as one of their test experiments. Clearly, Frank Conniff had gotten a screener sometime around Season 5, but either passed on it or didn't get the chance to license it at the time. And that's a good thing, because Season 6 is the proper place for The Beast of Yucca Flats, especially coming only two episodes after Red Zone Cuba, which I contend is the worst of the two. Many would disagree with me, but here's my argument. The Beast of Yucca Flats is more than a half an hour shorter, and it made for a funnier episode. It's ostensibly about a man played by Edward favorite former wrestler and MST3-peter Tor Johnson.
Joseph Jaworski, noted scientist.
And airplane.
Recently escaped from behind the Iron Curtain. Wife and children killed in Hungary. His aide carries a briefcase. Secret data on the Russian moonshot.
And a change of underpants.
Joseph Jaworski's destination. Yucca Flats. and a meeting with top brass at the A-bomb testing ground.
Avon testing ground? Rabbits with little shaved butts.
Oh, wait. I'm sorry. That's just Tor Johnson.
Mitch Jenkins pulls up. Destination, Yucca Flats, Superette.
Time for go to ground transportation.
Jaworski is exposed to a nuclear blast and becomes a hideous monster, which some people have suggested was the inspiration for the Incredible Hulk, who was created literally 1 year after this movie's release. But here's the issue with that theory. Stan Lee had a history of notoriously taking credit for the work of others, particularly Jack Kirby, but I doubt that he or King Kirby took time out of their bustling New York comic-creating career to trek over to bum-squat Arizona and manage to see the Beast of Yucca Flats on the back of some disreputable drive-in's triple bill. Other than the beast attacking people, I can't really go further into the plot, even with the aid of the internet, because there isn't any. Things happen without any sense of structure or consequence, and actors will simply be captured on celluloid between poses looking miserable, which, being familiar with the Francis filmography, is probably a case of bad art imitating shitty life.
There was no such thing as clinical depression until this film was made.
She was in a Bergman film where she played low self-esteem.
Today's Romanian woman.
Sidebar. The location of Yucca Flats is based on an actual nuclear testing ground, Yucca Flat, the most irradiated spot on the face of the Earth. Yucca Mountain, which has been a repository for nuclear waste since 1987, featured prominently in all of Coleman Francis's movies, making the recurring themes of sorrow and decay all the more literal. End sidebar. The movie opens with a nude woman getting dressed, then being strangled by the beast, although this occurs before Jaworski becomes said beast, and it's never referred to again. That's because Coleman simply enjoyed nude scenes. He never bothered to justify it with a point. When cut for MST3K, we just see the strangling, making the scene even more extraneous. Because he was too broke to roll sound on set, if his actors talk, they only say lines of dialogue off-camera, which has a disorienting effect. Towards the end of the film, there comes a scene where a man and a woman have just finished having sex in a bedroom. Cut to a barely visible person outside the house where presumably that bedroom is located. A voice from a recording booth meant to represent that person calls out to the man inside the bedroom, saying that they have to go. Cut to an interior shot of the man walking out of the bedroom, zooming in on the woman staring into the middle distance and definitely not where the man would be in her eyeline.
See you later, honey.
Coleman Francis solves the problem of sound sync.
That is, for this movie, a successful example of interpersonal communication. To make things worse, Coleman is forced out of necessity to narrate his own quote-unquote story in post-production, but does so with a dispassionate sense of cryptic profundity, spouting questions and oblique sentence fragments that suggest that there is some mysterious wisdom beneath the surface, but I think we all know better.
Flag on the moon. How did it get there?
These are all just random sentences, folks.
This does have all the earmarks of a KGB operation.
Secret data. Pictures of the moon.
Nude.
The mouth of the cave 1,000 feet up over jagged cliffs. A man murdered. A woman's purse.
A thin plot, endlessly restated.
110 in the shade.
130 in my pants.
No shade. Jim and Joe try to make their way up to the plateau. To reach the top, a man needs an airplane.
Or a big pogo stick.
A jump from a plane could land you on top.
Or a helicopter might do. Did I say flag on the moon yet?
The hunter and the hunted.
This fall on ABC.
With only a few hundred yards between him and the enemy, Jim closes in for the kill.
Just as Jim closes in for the kill, so does Mutual of Omaha close in for the kill.
Sometimes he lets music tell the story for him, certifying his credentials as a man who took the wheel with the word action, but was passed out in the backseat by the word cut.
This here part doesn't need any narration, folks. It stands on its own.
Now would be a good time for some phrases. A woman's purse. Flag on the moon. A man murdered. I'll check back in a moment.
He seems to genuinely hate his creation as much as the audience eventually did, probably writing narration on cocktail napkins during a break in editing and inserting them wherever the cutters couldn't find a Foley effect or an absurdly inappropriate music cue.
He leads to the strains of the Cherokee Jack theme. Cherokee, Cherokee, Cherokee Jack. Cherokee,
Cherokee. Oh boy, another great car approaching scene.
How do you decide when to turn on your lights in a Coleman Francis movie?
Bartok music really makes the scene.
You know, this could be Coleman Francis's very best car approaching sequence ever.
No.
Yes.
Have a cup of coffee and a roll, and maybe that's a roll, and maybe then some crullers and a Danish one or two.
Young Joe Dobson, desert patrolman.
Lover of fine wines.
Maybe of lost gloves.
Speaking of editing, Coleman takes sole credit for this duty, modestly billed as C. Francis, as if that's going to throw anyone off the scent. But producer Anthony Cardoza, Tony to his bill collectors, insisted that he, production supervisor Austin McKinney, and cinematographer Lee Strohsnyder shared the job with no input from Coleman. Yes, it took three men to edit what is essentially a collage of B-roll that would be rejected for an ACI Films industrial short about whether or not corn is grass, a subject that we'll get into greater detail in Chapter 15. This B-roll, as narrative, can be divided into a few categories. There's what would become Coleman's standard fetish of footage of cars driving and eventually coming to a stop.
Coleman Francis, the cinematic poet of parking.
Coleman Francis had a dark, muddy vision with some cars.
Yep.
Well. Come on.
Bring it on over here now.
There are shots of people moving through exterior locations that don't establish a sense of environment.
Shoot first, ask questions later.
Ask Christian Slater?
Shoot the film first, ask questions later.
And finally, the aforementioned random shots of miserable people.
This movie stops at nothing and stays there.
The movie was shot over the course of a year, which means that Coleman either had a driving vision that he felt compelled to share with the rest of the world, or that he badly needed to sell distribution rights to some product to cover gambling debts or a massive bar tab. And I'm going to lean on the latter, despite it being pure spiteful speculation. It's an entirely confounding experience, and the writers and performers of MST3K are forced to tap dance until their toes are broken and bleeding, which makes for some truly unexpected avenues of comedy and moments of meanness that still pack a catty punch.
Huh. She's an attractive man.
Ugh.
Okay, breasts, we get it.
That's a hard face. That's a face that challenges you.
Yep.
It's the perfect end to a truly bewildering trilogy, enhanced even more by the first and only instance of using two short subjects to round out the runtime, the second of which may be my favorite 12 minutes of the entire Comedy Central era. But we'll get to that in the epilogue to this chapter in about a month. When you have deep hurting, Coleman Francis style, it's hard for the host segments to fully match the experiments that they frame. But that never stopped the writers from trying, previous Urkel-centric sketches aside. The Skydivers opens with a prologue that is essentially a one-joke premise, which is exactly the point, but also demonstrates an endearing character trait. Servo's lashing out when he's being undermined or disrespected by Crow being a bad brother. Servo, always the theatrical one, tries to take central focus and demonstrate his considerable intellect by turning himself into a planetarium.
Ba-da! Welcome, space travelers, to the Tom Star Show.
But Crow decides to play both Statler and Waldorf to Servo's Fozzie Bear in the crudest way.
Fasten your seatbelts. First stop, the planet Mars.
Take me to Uranus.
Mars, the brightest star in our galaxy.
Hey, let's probe Uranus.
Patience, space traveler. We'll visit all the planets.
What? Are you ashamed of Uranus?
Crow! Gee, I'm just trying to do a little show here.
Oh, excuse me, I have some questions about Uranus.
Let's save our questions for the appropriate question and answer.
Uranus is big and gassy, isn't it?
But shut up. But ours is not the only planetary system.
Servo, we have to get to Uranus and wipe out the Klingons.
Shut
shut up! Just shut up! Just shut the TV!
We'll be right back.
Where'd he go?
Segment 1 features a swing choir battle between the SOL and Deep 13, with medleys of classic musicals and pop songs that range from the Beach Boys to Sinatra, and is especially funny when tone-deaf Gypsy joins in.
Get around, round, round, she gets around.
This land is your land.
This land is my land?
That's right.
From California to New York, our land.
Segment 4 is the second installment of a running gag that originated in Zombie Nightmare, of Crow minding his own business, only to be brutalized by an oblivious servo. First he was run down while reading, and this time he's obsessing over his new hot rod, itself a reference to a sketch from season 4, when Joel gifted Servo a cherry red sports car and Crow, expecting a similar present, instead got dress slacks, when Servo, who now owns a plane, goes on the warpath.
Unknown vehicle on desk, please acknowledge. Unknown vehicle, acknowledge, over.
The hell?
Car on desk, acknowledge. Vehicle not responding. Mandatory termination procedure begun in the name of God and country. Beautiful, beautiful. Splash one, splash one. Look at the carnage. Termination complete. Acceptable losses. Let's go home.
Damn you, Servo!
But my favorite moment of the episode comes at the very end during the letter segment, and I think I'm reading into it.
You all do excellent work. The show has to be the funniest thing to hit the airwaves since Chips. I love that show. Remember Punch and Judy on Chips?
Who's Punch and
I'm finally getting out of college and heading to a long, toilsome life as an accountant. If Tom Crow or Gypsy need investment advice, I'm not the one to come to.
That's cute.
All right, hey, Nuvina, feel free to warp in any time.
Say.
Oh, thanks, Ben. Thanks for bringing that up.
This is a reference to 12 to the Moon, which was season 5's season finale. When Nuvina, played by Bridget Nelson, née Jones, visits and almost brings Mike to her planet for wedded bliss. I've always interpreted the look on Mike's face when he reads that letter as Mike the person annoyed that somebody is hitting on his wife. It's probably Mike the character missing the presence of a human woman, but I think my version of events is better. Red Zone Cuba is an episode with a theme running through that begins right after the prologue. As it happens, Frank is in deep to the mob for 50 large. When some goons arrive in Deep 13 to collect, Forrester is tricked into answering the door and is beaten so badly that he spends the entire episode on a stretcher covered in bandages and hooked up to various IVs filled with brightly colored substances. Sidebar. Trace Beaulieu directed this episode, which means that he had to call shots in scenes where he was covered head to toe in fake bandages. Does not sound easy. End sidebar. Frank is then responsible for Dr. F's convalescence, which goes poorly. First, he takes over the experiment hosting duties.
And then, if Dr. Forrester lives through this, he's going to beat the living crap. Well, enjoy the experiment, guys. Hey, look, Dr. F, I got you something. Some nuts and some hard-boiled eggs.
And soon, he's impatiently instructing a delirious Forrester to walk into the light and die already, as well as receiving various correspondence from people that wish him harm. And it's more varied than you'd expect.
Sorry, Clay. It's pretty hopeless. Been going through your mail, though. Oh, look at this. It's a card from Leo Biscaglia. Hope you die, you rotten best. Hello?
Hello, Frank.
It's Jimmy Carter. Yes, Mr. President.
Is he dead yet?
I'll let you know just as soon as he dies.
You do
yes,
that,
sir,
Frank.
Mr. President.
You call me.
Just
you
as
call
soon.
Me here?
Okay, bye-bye now.
Bye-bye,
goodbye,
Frank.
Yeah, bye-bye. Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye, Frank.
That was nice. And look what Mother Teresa sent us. Oh, you know, it's true. One life touches so many others.
It's a wreath and a placard proclaiming, "Hope you die." Heartwarming stuff. Meanwhile, on the SOL, the movie takes a serious toll on Mike, and the pain causes him to have an identity crisis, going so far as to dress in drag and believe that he's Carol Channing. When the movie's over, he and the bots overcome their woes by improvising a bouncy upbeat song, cleverly titled, "Bouncy Upbeat Song."
whenever I want to cry and bawl because I'm feeling sad.
Yeah?
I think of ironing boards and drywall, and then I don't feel so bad.
Whenever I'm feeling down and blue and sorry for myself,
oh.
I get some staples and some glue, and I'm happy as an elf.
Whenever I start to mope and pout, and there's nothing left in my soul, I check the toilet paper, and if we're out, I buy another roll.
So if you listen to our advice,
and you want to feel terrific,
do things that make you feel nice.
I wish we could be more specific.
That probably took 2 hours to write, but it's sweet. Wrapping up, let's make our way back to the Beast of Yucca Flats, which opens with a political stump speech way down in Deep 13.
Simply put, Proposition Deep 13 means that we will send you today's experiment, the Beast of Yucca Flats. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. And it will crush the satellite of love, Nelson, because we've signed a contract with America. Tell him what we're sending him, Frank.
We're sending you a wake-up call named the Beast of Yucca Flats.
Take that, counterculture.
You're out of touch, and we hate you.
Thank you. Our message is a simple one. Crow. Crow. For we have struggled, yet we have prevailed. Through... Please, thank you. Through the dark days of outlaw and the creeping terror... Yet we shall triumph, for we are somebody.
Yeah.
Oh, really? Even if I tell you that the Beast of Yucca Flats is another motion picture from Coleman Francis? Well, I think we can survive.
We're doomed. We have been forsaken.
Segment 3 is actually based on true events. In it, Crow is constantly pestering Mike to inform him when it's 11:30, which is lunchtime.
Now is 11:30?
No.
Well, how soon till 11:30 is it?
Oh, you don't want to know.
It has to be 11:30 now.
It is so not 11:30.
It can't not be 11:30.
It couldn't be less 11:30.
Is it 11:30, Mike?
Ah, it's completely 11:30.
When will it be 11:30 again, Mike?
Don't. Well, we just went through the. We got movie
what,
sign.
What? Take your sandwich.
While it's essentially one premise stretched as far as humanly possible, Crow's time-wasting techniques are adorably childish, including his distinctive hum from Season 4's Monster A Go-Go, the origin of which will apparently always remain a mystery. The constant pestering is based on Frank Conniff's frequent interruptions in the writer's room of when it was time to finally have lunch, as he had usually skipped breakfast. To be fair, this is how I also behave during my day job, but since nobody talks to me there, the countdown is all in my head. And that, dear listener, was a sad look into my life that you did not need, but you now know anyway. You're welcome. The final sketch we'll discuss this week is somewhat of a cliffhanger, pun certainly intended. It features Crow yet again, this time hosting a call to action reminiscent of a PBS fundraiser commercial break, only without any mention of Are You Being Served? And it's a segment that actually inspired me to do something very stupid.
Hello, I'm Crow T. Robot of the Satellite of Love. You know, the Beast of Yucca Flats, Skydivers, and Red Zone Cuba are just three examples of the many, many god-awful films made during this century. Tragically, films like these are not deteriorating fast enough. That's why I urge you to support FAPS, the Film Anti-Preservation Society. At FAPS, we're devoted to allowing the films of Coleman Francis and countless others to die a gentle, natural death. We'll use your donations to transfer these films to fragile, volatile silver nitrate stock, so they'll rot quickly into nature's compost. Now, here's how you can help.
If you find a copy of a film as bad as Aspen Extreme, please store it in a warm, moist, salty place, such as a cheese factory or your mouth. The situation is serious. If we don't take action now, the entire filmography of Sylvester Stallone may be available for our children and our grandchildren to view.
Yeah, about that filmography. It's quite long and full of dark, marble-mouthed horrors. And if one were to watch almost all those movies, it could make for some interesting, painful podcasting. And it is on that ominous note in which we end this hour of the podcast. Next time, we're going to pump the brakes on Season 6 and MST3K, but ignore Crow T. Robot's warning and take a very deep dive into the cinematic resume of the Italian Stallion. The highs of Rocky 1 and First Blood, the lows of virtually everything else. The Film Anti-Preservation Society presents a very special event, the world's first anti-film festival starring Sylvester Stallone. If you are cognizant of the 80s and early to mid-90s and have a soft spot for shitty movies, you are going to want to tune in for this. Unless you think they're good, in which case I'm going to hurt your feelings. All that and much, much more on next week's daunting chapter of the Coolness Chronicles. But before we sign off for the week, I'd like to introduce my favorite segment of the first half of this season of the podcast, when you, the listener, share with me the movies you love. It's time for Random Recommendations. This week's recommendation comes from my friend Mary Muley. In fact, here she is to tell us all about it.
I found the movie Free Fire because I'll watch anything with Cillian Murphy. A cast list that also included Brie Larson and Armie Hammer, and a trailer that made it look like a tense firefight piqued my interest. The movie centers around 9 people at a warehouse gun deal that goes bad when Harry, one of the dealers, sees Steve-O, one of the buyers, who had assaulted his 17-year-old cousin. They scuffle and argue while everyone else tries to calm the situation until Harry shoots Steve-O, and so begins the longest gunfight in movie history, with 55 minutes from the first shot to the last. Within minutes, almost everyone is bleeding. They spend the rest of the movie hiding, peeking out to shoot, yelling insults, and strategizing escapes. Most of this takes place with everyone crawling on the ground because they are too injured to stand. Even though it's bloody action, the movie has its humor. One scene, a character who was downed with a head injury and presumed dead pops up and walks around, shooting for 5 minutes while looking for the money brought for the deal. With it in hand, he begins to leave, only to fall dead for real. It's funny because everyone is so shocked to see him walking around, scalp open, brain visible, that they stop shooting and just watch. I enjoyed this movie for its humor, but mostly the ridiculousness of it. A gunfight in a warehouse between 9 people who sell and buy guns should have ended more quickly, but I think that's told in the name, Free Fire. A bunch of people on the ground, bleeding to death, firing away, just hoping they hit someone. It's just a fun watch.
As Mary just said, Free Fire is essentially one long shootout between 9 people in a warehouse, but there's one added element. It's set in the 1970s, a time when fashion was horrendous and facial hair was even worse. Because of this setting, my amusement regarding the chain of events in the film is amplified by the sight of Armie Hammer looking like young Jim Henson in a turtleneck, a bunch of white British character actors dressed like Lando Calrissian, and the appearance of the lovely and amazing Brie Larson, who isn't at all hampered by the tacky fashion because she's just that goddamn amazing. Aside from the fashion, which is inherently funny without much comment necessary, this particular blend of pitch-black comedy weaved into the tapestry of cuts, scrapes, and gunshot wounds makes for some twisted fun, especially when some of the more unscrupulous, nefarious characters bitch and moan and even cry about their situation or react to their injuries or the death of their compatriots.
Hey, I know I speak for everybody when I express my sympathies to Steven for the loss of his special friend.
Fuck Steven, man! He started the whole thing. He shot the boy.
I'm not dead.
I'm just regrouping.
Fucking hang ahead and save what they've done today. That's right, you're a fucking angel, man. You're a fucking angel sent from heaven, that's what you are.
Anyway, I'm sure Bernie's off to a better place. Maybe he'll even make something of himself down there.
I'm fucking grieving here!
Fucking grieving.
The film was co-written and directed by Ben Wheatley, an English filmmaker who's been making small, interesting genre pieces for the last decade, like Kill List, Sightseers, and High Rise. Wheatley's keen eye for atmosphere really comes in handy here, considering that it's essentially the bottle episode equivalent of a film, which could easily become stale if you're trapped in the same environment for 90 minutes. And there's a lesson to learn from all the unrepentant violence. When you're having a shootout that involves crawling around on all fours, make sure that you're in a sanitary environment. The poor bastards in this film are definitely all getting gangrene or hepatitis or both. Not Brie, though. Did I already mention how amazing she is? Thank you to everyone involved in making MST3K for everything that they've contributed to my life and culture as a whole. Double thanks for writing the episode guide that I will quote frequently in this season of the pod. I also want to thank Shout Factory for their excellent supplemental material that was invaluable to my research for this and every episode to follow on this subject. If you want to support the artists who made this wonderful show, many episodes are available on VOD at rifftracks.com. And thank you for listening. If you enjoy what you hear, please rate and review the show on iTunes or your chosen source. Share it with anyone you can, any way you can. This has been the largest and most fulfilling endeavor I've ever seen to completion, and it would be nice to keep making the show until it just isn't fun anymore. Have questions, comments, or random recommendations, or is there anything I missed in this particular chapter? Contact me on Twitter at CoolnessPodRyan or on our Facebook page, and keep on the lookout for updates. Until next week, do what you love, don't be a dick, and as always...
Well, the real Hitchcock would be proud of this shot, though.
Alfred Hitchcock?
Oh, no, no, no. Tammy, the real Hitchcock. Hitchcock. She's a prostitute. She's responsible for many of the stains in this hotel's drapes.
Okay.
Chronicles is written, produced, and edited by Ryan Rodriguez. Executive producers are Tracy Rodriguez and Luis Rodriguez. Original music by Bildschirm. Please visit bildschirm.bandcamp.com for more information.